The Australian bushfires are horrendous. At least 18 people dead, thousands of homes destroyed, millions of hectares of land torched, half a billion animals burned alive. Look at this satellite image of the country. It's absolutely terrifying. And all because of climate change, right?
Make no mistake, the tragedy unfolding in Australia is climate change based.
Wrong. For weeks, we've been bombarded with this relentless, sustained narrative that man-made global warming caused and exacerbated this disaster.
This is the kind of emergency that scientists say is made much more likely and more damaging by climate change.
Climate change.
Climate change.
Climate change.
Climate change.
And it's all total. Guess what the primary cause of these fires was? People deliberately starting the fires. Australian authorities are now working on the premise that, quote, arson is to blame for much of the devastation caused this bushfire season.
Firebugs known to be responsible for lighting deliberately lit fires like this one.
Were the fires intentionally started? Police have formed Strike Force Indara, comprising detectives from homicide and arson squads.
Last time I checked, people deliberately starting fires had nothing whatsoever to do with CO2-driven planetary climate change. Figures obtained by news agency AAP show that nearly 200 people across the country have already been arrested or investigated by police for deliberately starting the fires. Nearly 200 people identified as having started these fires, and probably hundreds more who have not been identified. In Queensland, police concluded that 103 of the fires had been deliberately lit, with 98 people, 67 of them juveniles, having been identified as the culprits. According to Dr. Paul Reed, co-director of the National Centre for Research in Bushfire and Arson, around 85% of bushfires are caused by humans either deliberately or accidentally starting them. About 85% are related to human activity, 13% confirmed arson, and 37% suspected arson, he said. The remainder are usually due to reckless fire lighting or even just children playing with fire. The disaster has also been made worse by the timing. It's the school holidays in Australia and many of the firebugs are teenagers. The other main reason why the fires are raging is because green environmentalist policies have outlawed property owners doing controlled burns that create fire breaks to prevent infernos spreading. As Miranda Devine explains, governments appeasing the green beast have ignored numerous state and federal bushfire inquiries over the past decade, almost all of which have recommended increasing the practice of prescribed burning, also known as hazard reduction. It's a methodical regime of burning off flammable ground cover in cooler months in a controlled fashion so it does not fuel the inevitable summer bushfires. In East Gippsland in the state of Victoria, protesters successfully stopped one of these controlled burns from happening, with one protester quoted as saying, "I'm more worried about climate change." So because of green policies preventing the vital forest management process of clearing areas via controlled reduction burns, these bushfires have spread far quicker. In many parts of Australia, trees were legally designated as carbon sinks to offset CO2 emissions. This made it illegal for Australians to fell trees on their own property to create fire breaks. This then aggravated the spread of the bushfires. A firefighter was fined $100,000 for creating a fire break on his own property. And surprise, surprise, his house was the only one that survived the bushfires in his area. Because, and I know this is hard to believe, fire breaks prevent the spread of fires. These environmental regulations that outlawed the creation of fire breaks worsened the previous Australian bushfire disaster in 2009. They knew this for at least a decade, yet the same laws remained in place thanks to the green lobby. So the very same enviro-extremists pointing the finger at you and I for our carbon emissions, exacerbating the bushfires, are themselves infinitely more responsible for exacerbating the bushfires. They're the ones responsible for the half a billion dead animals, and they've got the nerve to point the finger in the opposite direction. Data also shows there's been no significant decrease in rainfall in the affected regions. Droughts in the affected regions were caused by a natural weather phenomenon, the Indian Ocean Dipole, not by man-made climate change. Temperatures haven't been significantly higher either. In fact, during the years 1899 to 1901, average December mean maximum temperatures were well above 38 degrees. As James Dellingpole writes, to be clear, there is zero evidence of any change in climatic conditions that might have increased the likelihood or severity of these bushfires. This is not, repeat, not a man-made climate change story, and anyone who claims otherwise is either a gullible idiot or a lying charlatan. To emphasize the point, the two main factors causing and exacerbating the bushfires in Australia, people deliberately starting the fires and environmentalist regulations, are not even being mentioned, never mind debated, in the vast majority of mainstream media reporting on this subject. The BBC did a 12-minute piece about the bushfires, and neither of those factors were mentioned once. What they did mention was the apparent solution: to eliminate carbon emissions entirely. A process that would completely devastate the economy and hurt poor people.
So around 50,000 workers in Australia are connected to the fossil fuel industry, and we know that around 60% of Australia's electricity comes from coal-fired power stations.
Great, let's put thousands of working-class people out of work. Let's make fuel prices completely unaffordable for those on low or no incomes. Let's alienate and anger another generation of resentful rural inhabitants left behind by globalism. A generation who are already out on the streets in France, Germany and Holland protesting against these very same environmentalist regulations, simply to make middle-class virtue signalers feel better about themselves as they spew hysterical, debunked nonsense about climate change, while they lobby for green policies that actually make bushfires worse. Great idea. And listen, I know it's very easy to be emotionally manipulated by images of burned koalas and dead baby kangaroos, lulled into believing that if you just give your masters more power to tax, more power to regulate, more power to control, that they can make it all go away. But they can't make human stupidity and the sheer awesome force of Mother Nature ever go away. And they're lying to you. When are we going to stop listening to these people? They've been caught lying time and time again, whether it be the experts who told us at the end of the 70s that a new ice age was coming, Paul Ehrlich's prediction that hundreds of millions of people would die of starvation due to crop failure by the 1980s, or the 2004 prediction that major European cities would be underwater and that Britain would be plunged into a Siberian climate by 2020. Or Al Gore's doomsday warning that the Arctic would have ice-free summers by 2013. None of it happened. And yet now a certain teenage climate activist who is beyond question is spewing the exact same BS.
How dare you?
Someone whose message is amplified by the likes of Leonardo DiCaprio, a dude who takes private jets to pick up environmental awards and hangs out on 400-foot gas-guzzling yachts owned by Middle Eastern oil billionaires. Someone whose message is amplified by Prince Harry and Meghan Markle, a couple who took four private jet trips in the space of just 11 days, mainly so they could party at Elton John's mansion. Someone whose message is amplified by Arnold Schwarzenegger, a dude who has a garage full of muscle cars and tanks. No thanks. I'm gonna stop listening to those people, and I'm gonna realize that climate change policies aren't meant to control the climate. They're meant to control you. It's absolutely crucial for you to help me fight the war on free speech by supporting me via Subscribestar, link in description, and also signing up for my free newsletter at summit.news/newsletter. If you were looking for final confirmation that God has totally abandoned the human race, look no further than 2019. The end to the year once again illustrated how we truly do live in the stupidest time in human history. The UK ended 2019 by getting angry over some idiot who killed a fox. 200,000 babies are aborted in the UK every year. Brits. One fox is killed.
Well, then everyone loses their minds.
Also, foxes are bastards. They viciously attack and try to kidnap babies. You care more about street vermin than your own biological progeny. Fuck foxes. Foxes are bastards. Stormzy ended 2019 by whining about how racist the UK is. Yeah, the UK's so racist that Stormzy, a black son of African immigrants, gets to go from being raised by a single mother in a ghetto to becoming a multi-millionaire celebrity with a giant soapbox to complain about how oppressed he is. So racist. The UK is so racist, the worst performing ethnic group in the entire country when it comes to education is white working class boys. So racist. A 2019 study published in the Frontiers in Sociology journal found Britain to be one of the least racist countries in Europe. Less racist than Spain, Germany, and France. The study found that, quote, prejudice against immigrants, other races, Muslims, Hindus, Jews, and Gypsies are all relatively low in the UK, and that Brexit has not worsened this trend. So racist! When you look at a map of countries least tolerant of neighbours from another race, most of them are non-white. But the UK's racist. The UK is so racist, we import around 600,000 immigrants every single year, most of whom come from non-white countries. So racist. Meanwhile, visitors to the Lake District are too able-bodied and white. Visitors to a rural, rugged hiking area are too able-bodied. Imagine that. But it is pretty racist to see so many white faces in an area that is demographically 95% white. And that has to change. Up next are visitors to the Great Wall of China, too Chinese. But none of this matters because according to climate change experts, on January 1st, the UK is going to be underwater. Back in 2004, they warned that Britain would be plunged into a Siberian climate by 2020. Just like they told us millions would die from famine by the 1980s, and that the Arctic would have ice-free summers by 2013. It's almost like they're lying by whipping up hysteria to generate money, power, and entrench control over your lives. Surely not.
How dare you?
Meanwhile, Western relationships are still totally f***ed. As are men and women. We've reached the tipping point where there are more Western females under the age of 30 who have multiple tattoos than those who can cook. And why does the Western media always celebrate pregnancy when the parents are transgender, while simultaneously telling biological women that having kids is bad for the planet and makes them worthless and unhappy? Transgender man gives birth to non-binary partner's baby with female sperm donor. There is no such thing as a female sperm donor. There is no such thing as a female sperm donor. There is no such thing as a female sperm donor. There is no such thing as a female sperm donor. There is no such thing as a female sperm donor. There is no such thing as a female sperm donor. As if there weren't enough soy boys in the West, Burger King is now selling the Impossible Whopper, a plant-based vegan burger that contains 18 million times more estrogen than the original beef Whopper. According to veterinarian James Stangle, that's enough estrogen to grow boobs on a male. Eat enough of them, and before long, you'll be sporting a pair of Impossible Whoppers.
Hello, darkness, my old friend. I've come to talk with you again.
There were some pretty good memes to end the year, like the Yes Chad. So you two are really just going to pursue a normal and healthy sex life built on love, mutual respect, and a genuine desire to see your partner happy? Yes. You want to ban abortion? How about banning porn? Are you fine with that? Yes. Islam is sexist, racist, homophobic, transphobic, anti-Semitic, and a threat to our liberal democratic society. Yes. You stole my daughter, you raped and sold her. Yes. Disavow. Are you going to burn dinner again? No. Disavow. But just like all great memes, either cringe conservatives or brainlet leftists eventually have to kill them.
Starting to fall in love with the yes meme.
You are destroying Western civilization. Yes. You can't fault them for their honesty. Some people are so stupid, they think Trump being impeached means he's no longer president.
You glad President Trump got impeached?
I'm really happy about that.
Yeah?
Oh, yeah.
Are you glad that Obama's coming in to take his spot?
Oh, yeah, really happy about that, too.
What do you think about Mike Pence? He takes office tomorrow.
Let him take office. Hopefully, he'll learn from it.
President Trump just got impeached yesterday. Are you excited for our new president, Mike Pence?
No, not excited for either one of them.
But that's going to be your president because he got impeached, right?
Mm-hmm.
Are you excited for Mike Pence to come into the presidency tomorrow because Trump got impeached?
It's whatever, you know. Like, I don't really care about it, to be honest.
Michael Moore proved once again that he's a massive racist.
I refuse to participate in post-racial America. I refuse to say because we elected Obama that suddenly that means everything's okay. White people have changed. White people have not changed. Two-thirds of all white guys voted for Trump. That means anytime you see three white guys walking at you down the street toward you, two of them voted for Trump. You need to move over to the other sidewalk because these are not good people that are walking towards you. You should be afraid of them.
It's funny that Michael Moore is afraid of white people because they seem to be afraid of him too. They've avoided going to see all of his recent documentaries like The Plague. A based armed boomer prevented dozens of people from being killed in Texas. It was probably the clearest example yet of how a good guy with a gun, in this case multiple good guys with guns, is a pretty decent method of preventing mass shootings. And how did the left react? By saying good guys with guns should be disarmed.
White Settlement is not only still a city name in 2019, it's also an 80%+ white suburb. I'm also disturbed that the shooter was killed not by police, but by churchgoers, which means they had their guns on their person while in church.
Pronouns in the bio.
Ken Paxton shouldn't be shocked by the church shooting in White Settlement. As Texas Attorney General, he specifically made sure that guns are allowed inside churches in the state.
Yeah, it's a good job that guns were allowed inside the church, otherwise 50+ people would be dead right now, you utter spoon. If the church had been a gun-free zone where only criminals who don't obey the law were allowed to show up, it would have been an absolute massacre.
So saddened to hear about another church shooting in Texas, this one in White Settlement near Fort Worth. Clearly what we are doing in Texas, what we are doing in this country when it comes to guns, is not working.
Clearly it is, given the fact that the shooter was neutralized after 6 seconds. Meanwhile, in New York...
5 people have been stabbed at the house of a rabbi in New York while celebrating the Jewish holiday Hanukkah. The suspect is believed to be in police custody after being found covered in blood. It's the latest in a spate of anti-Semitic threats and attacks on the Jewish community.
The situation in New York, and let's be clear, we don't know who perpetrated the Monsey attack yet, is massively complicated and a growing division among two communities. What we need right now is a way to find solidarity with each other against our shared enemy of white supremacy.
Two black supremacist terror attacks in America in the last 3 weeks, numerous other anti-Semitic hate crime incidents. Yet the media's moral panic seems to be nowhere near what we've seen in response to other attacks. Wonder why? But I don't want to continue feeding you nothing but black pills, so consider this. Bank of America says the dominant trend of the 2020s will be the end of globalization. Populist governments all over the world continue to win elections. Whenever woke progressivism or identity politics faces any kind of public referendum, be it TV ratings, box office income, music sales, or a national vote, time and time again, it's being soundly rejected. Brexit is finally happening. Most forecasts say Trump will win re-election. So happy New Year, and enjoy the white pills while they last. It's absolutely crucial for you to help me fight the war on free speech by supporting me via Subscribestar, link in description, and also signing up for my free newsletter at summit.news/newsletter.
My name's Luca Rossi, and this is what I wasn't told about climate change. I wasn't told that since the 1950s, polar bear numbers have increased by around 400%. I wasn't told water vapor is in fact the most abundant greenhouse gas, that CO2 only makes up 0.04% of the Earth's atmosphere, and only a fraction of that 0.04% is caused by humans. And I wasn't told there have been multiple times in the Earth's history where CO2 levels have been higher and temperature has been lower. I was told that 97% of scientists agree that human-induced climate change is happening and that the science is settled. But I wasn't told that there is no scientific consensus on the issue of climate change, and science is never really settled. In September, a global network of 500 scientists submitted a letter to the United Nations, stressing that there is no climate emergency, and their letter contained a lot of other things that I was never told. As Galileo said, in questions of science, the authority of 1,000 is not worth the humble reasoning of a single individual. Global warming has not increased natural disasters, and measures to fight climate change deny humans the life-giving benefits of electricity. I wasn't told physics Nobel Prize winner Ivor Jeever thinks climate change is a pseudoscience. I was told we will reach a tipping point in 11 years, the point of no return, that our world, at least the world as we know it, will end. I wasn't told about the countless failed predictions of climate disasters in the past. In 2006, in the film An Inconvenient Truth, Al Gore said that humanity had only 10 years left before the world would reach the point of no return. In the 1970s, there was scientific consensus that the Earth was heading into a period of significant cooling, or a possible ice age. In 2009, Prince Charles said we had 8 years to save the world from irretrievable climate and ecosystem collapse. I wasn't told about these past failed predictions. I also wasn't told about the one factor that all these predictions failed to account for: human ingenuity and creativity. The best way to help the planet and solve the problems facing humanity is to allow innovation, entrepreneurship, and human freedom to flourish. Since 1990, 1.2 billion people have overcome extreme poverty. That means 137,000 people have been lifted out of poverty every day for 25 years. It has never been a better time to be alive. So rather than worrying about the world ending in 50 years, or 11 years, or was it 18 months? Let's celebrate human achievement, be optimistic about the future, and use our precious time on Earth to make the world a better place. If you're like me, and you haven't been told about what's in this video and want to know more, go to the Generation Liberty Facebook page or generationliberty.org.au.
Last Thursday, the United States stepped on a cockroach. And within minutes, the progressive left were predictably demanding that we apologize to the greater cockroach community for it. So now here's a thought. No, you gutless waste of space pansies. Twitter. That wonderful website in which celebrities, typically known for throwing a ball or taking their clothes off, suddenly become experts in foreign policy and geopolitics overnight. Upon hearing the news that an American airstrike took out top Iranian commander Qasem Soleimani last Thursday, the left's terrorism apologists came out of the woodwork to beg Iran for mercy for killing their head oppressor-in-chief. Actress Rose McGowan tweeted her apologies to Iran on behalf of the United States, begging them, please, don't kill us. Colin Kaepernick took a break from being unemployed to get super woke and accuse America of racism, tweeting, America has always sanctioned and besieged black and brown bodies, both at home and abroad. American militarism is the weapon wielded by American imperialism to enforce its policing and plundering of the non-white world. Director Michael Moore posted on Instagram that he had actually messaged the Ayatollah of Iran, personally begging him for mercy, saying, I have just sent the Ayatollah of Iran a personal appeal asking him not to respond to our assassination of his top general with violence of any kind, but rather let me and millions of Americans fix this peacefully. I recorded and DM'd him a message on my podcast Rumble. When the Ayatollah responds, I'll post his reply.
I would like to ask you, as much as you have the right to, as much as I understand why you want to and are going to, I would like to ask you, the leadership of the country of Iran, to not respond with violence against the United States for what the United States has done to you this week.
Is this honestly what y'all have denigrated yourselves to? Really? How's that asphalt taste? Listen up, you sniveling, terrorist-hugging, America-hating, piss-in-your-pants cowards. Apologize for yourselves all you want. Bend over backwards to kiss the sandals of a dictatorial regime and their dirtbag terrorist hall monitor who we just blew sky high. Beg for forgiveness and mercy from one of the world's most oppressive, anti-freedom, women-hating regimes on the planet Earth. And while you're at it, feel free to book a one-way ticket to Tehran, assuming you possess the intellectual bandwidth to find it on a map. Maybe once you get there, ask for some complimentary tickets to the next gay rooftop skydiving party. I hear it's a riot. Go ahead and prove yourself to have the spinal fortitude of a wet spaghetti noodle. Be my guest. I get that to you, bravery means prancing around in a pink hat with a picket sign in a country that already guarantees freedom of speech, and anything that requires actual risk or sacrifice is to be avoided like the plague. So go ahead, please. But you don't apologize for me. You don't get to beg for forgiveness for those of us who still believe in not kowtowing to terrorists, who don't accept that hostile nations get to assault our embassy and kill our contractors and murder our soldiers and blast our drones out of the sky, and we're just going to cower in terror. So y'all go right ahead and hide under your Louis Vuitton couch in your Beverly Hills mansion clutching your keyboard and prove yourselves the most pathetic excuse for an American this side of the revolution. I can't stop you from being a coward. All I can do is thank God above that our military is made of much stronger stuff. And that's your reality check, America. Make sure you subscribe to our YouTube page, like us on Facebook and Twitter, and stay sane out there. Climate alarmists were out in full force over the weekend screaming about how we're all going to die if we don't immediately ban plastic, stop eating cows, and immediately ban all fossil fuels. Now, here is why no one takes them seriously. Because this has nothing to do with saving the planet. It is about government taking control of your life. And all the lemmings are buying right into it. So here's the deal. I'm a millennial. I happen to think that we could do a much better job of protecting our planet. I don't subscribe to the doom and gloom theory that we're all going to die in the next decade because the oceans are going to start boiling over. But I do have an issue when I see piles of plastic trash floating out in the Pacific. I don't use plastic whenever possible, and I think we should stop using styrofoam. I recycle more than I throw away. And I think that the free market should drive more change. But there is a reason why no one with a brain takes climate alarmists seriously. Here's a good example. Some fools over at Union Seminary in New York City photoed themselves confessing their eco-sins to plants. Plants. See, there's a major difference between wanting to find new ways to better care for the planet and literally praying to your ficus tree. Then last Friday, public schools turned hundreds of thousands of students loose into the streets to scream about climate change. Here's how that went down.
This is a fight for our lives, for our security, for all future generations to come. They want us to just sit quiet? No! They want us to just sit in school and learn about a future that may not exist? No! Doom and gloom and not existing. We are here to create! Yeah. We are creating this movement every day because every day of inaction drives more action from us!
Anyone who thinks that this is helping the planet, raise your hand. Congratulations! You are a moron. See, here's the problem. This little boy has been crying wolf for an awful long time. This new generation is just the latest to buy into it. I know all the 16-year-olds who stomped through the streets last Friday don't remember any of this, but Al Gore was making crazy doomsday predictions back before you were a tadpole. And according to him, we're all supposed to be dead by now about five times over. Yeah. See, back in 2007, Al said that the summer sea ice in the Arctic would be entirely gone by the year 2013. It's not. In his 2006 film, An Inconvenient Truth, he predicted the seas would be risen by about 20 feet by now. They've risen about 1 to 3 millimeters a year. He claimed climate change was killing the polar bears. Their population rose by more than 50%. And it did not start with him. Harvard biologist George Wald said back in 1970 that civilization would cease to exist within 15 or 30 years. Paul Ehrlich wrote that in the 1980s, the majority of the world would be in a famine. North Texas State University professor Peter Gunter predicted that by 2000, every single country besides Europe, North America, and Australia would be starving to death. Ecologist Kenneth Watt said we'd all be in an irreversible ice age by the turn of the millennium, and that by the year 2000, we would have run out of crude oil. And those are just a few. But despite the fact that all of these crazy apocalyptic prophecies did not even come close to being true, Chicken Little is still running around screaming that the sky is falling. Last Friday, when thousands of teenagers took to the streets of the world's major cities to demand politicians act on climate change, they have been brainwashed into believing leftist politicians were all too happy to take advantage of them and use these kids as political props to try to score points. Like if we just elect them, they'll save us all from imminent doom. See, psychologists report that an increasing number of their underage patients are being put on medication to help them cope with eco-anxiety. Many people have started actual support groups to help them combat the stress of being terrified over climate change. And here's where the government swoops in. See, they know that if you're scared, you'll give them control. Control of the economy, control of energy, control of food, control of your life. These guys thrive on fear. They need you to be so scared you'll surrender your freedom and your independence to the government that promises to keep you safe. According to Andrew Yang, this means that we need to up the price of beef so that people can't afford to eat it, which will disproportionately penalize the poor. To Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, this means we have to tax everyone into poverty to rebuild every building in America, shut down our airports, and stop the cows from farting. To Bernie Sanders, it means encouraging women to abort their babies up through the 9th month of pregnancy for population control. See, for liberal politicians, climate change means destroying the free market in the name of saving the earth. This isn't about the planet, or saving our species, or making sure the Great Coral Reef stays colorful. This is about the government stepping in to run your life. And when they can't convince you to give up your freedom nicely, they use fear. And that's your reality check, America. Make sure that you subscribe to our YouTube page, like us on Facebook and Twitter, and stay sane out there.
They use their media to assassinate real news. They use their schools to teach children that their president is another Hitler. They use their movie stars and singers and comedy shows and award shows to repeat their narrative over and over again. And then they use their ex-president to endorse the resistance, all to make them march, make them protest, make them scream racism and sexism and xenophobia and homophobia, to smash windows, burn cars, shut down interstates and airports, bully and terrorize the law-abiding, until the only option left is for the police to do their jobs and stop the madness. And when that happens, they'll use it as an excuse for their outrage. The only way we stop this, the only way we save our country and our freedom, is to fight this violence of lies with the clenched fist of truth. I'm the National Rifle Association of America, and I'm freedom's safest place.
What makes America's military the most fearsome force on Earth isn't just the weapons, equipment, or technology. It's the flag beneath which we serve. From the shores of Tripoli and Normandy to the jungles of Vietnam and the streets of Baghdad and Kandahar, America's armed forces fight with courage, selflessness, and noble purpose unmatched and undefeated. We've always known that behind our line stands every hope for human freedom on this earth. So let me say this to all who serve or who have served. If you want to continue your fight to keep freedom alive, there's a nearly 6 million member force that would be truly proud to add your name to our ranks. I'm the National Rifle Association of America, and I'm freedom's safest place.
We understand we live in a dangerous world. The enemies of freedom are real, and we need to be ready to defend all of our freedoms.
Freedom to me is ability to live how I see fit to live.
That's exactly what this country was founded on, was freedom. It is in danger.
The elites and their ideology are destroying this country. We're losing the America that we all love.
Gun rights are under assault.
It's important that we fight for our freedom.
We're at a critical stage.
We are freedom's safest place.
The Second Amendment, after freedom of speech and religion, it was the first thing our founding fathers thought of. That is the pinnacle of freedom.
It's about my safety, and I'm going to fight for my safety.
I love the freedom that I have. I'm appreciative of the NRA for fighting for that freedom.
And they're on the front lines doing something to defend our rights and the voice of the people.
It protects law-abiding citizens.
The work that the NRA does is important, preserving freedom and liberty.
Keeping people informed, raising awareness about what's going on in the country.
They are the protector of our freedoms.
The NRA stands for freedom.
In the face of this relentless onslaught of gun control schemes, you're the reason the Second Amendment still stands. You're the tip of the spear.
You're the ones that make it possible for us every day to defend this freedom.
They're fighting for our fundamental freedoms. I mean, I can't think of anything more important than that.
One person to politicians in Washington is nothing, but together, as members of the NRA, we actually can have a voice.
We must lead the way, and we must save our freedom.
We're going to fight for the America we believe in. This is a fight for our freedom.
We need to reawaken the passion and pride and unity of purpose that made this country so special.
We're the National Rifle Association of America. We're born to fight, and we're not going anywhere.
Stand up if you want to protect your right to protect yourself. Stand up if you believe in freedom. Stand up and every day speak out. And we're going to stand for freedom and fight. We will not be silent.